Bonjour Thomas, good morning Professor Philippon. It's a huge pleasure to have you today here. It's a great pleasure to be able to talk to you because you've been doing a fantastic job that has been very, very useful to all of us. Your last book was a bestseller and is even an audiobook, which is not often the case for economic books. So it's been widely and well listened to. Let me just quickly introduce Professor Philippon. He's a professor of finance at NYU, Stern of Business, School of Business, and one of the world leading economists. He graduated for Polytechnic X and have a PhD of MIT. Let me just say a word about that, because he belongs to a tradition now which is becoming very, very strong of French economists who have been trained in French Grande École. Particularly X, and will go and study in the US, and that combination is producing currently a very strong stream of excellent economists. And I think that Tirole and Lafont were the precursor of that, and Blanchard, and we see a lot of work coming from these economists, and Thomas is one of them. He's actually one of the leading young economists. He was named one of the top 25 economists under 45 by the IMF. He have won the Bernasser Prize for Best European Economist. He was awarded Best French Economist. So the list of awards is very long. So I can go on and on, but I'm sure that you want to listen to what he's telling us about it. Let me just, Thomas. The reason why I read your book in one go is that I was very, very, what you just said at the beginning, I felt it as well. When you come from Europe or from other parts of the world, for your idea of competition is that the US is a land of competition. All the goods that you have mentioned, computers, IT, were much more expensive in Europe at that time. And you were saying, okay, what happened? So what you are saying in your book is that unfortunately things went backward, and you're talking about two things, which are a bad and good concentration. And if I have understood properly, you define good concentration as low price and productivity growth, and bad concentration as high price and low productivity. So can you just explain to all of us, what do you mean by these two concepts?
Yeah, so first of all, thank you very much for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be with you and to chat with you. So I think the starting point is that, so if we look at the data, we see that in many industries, many measures of concentration, and by concentration, just to be clear, we just mean the market share of the big firms. Okay, that doesn't mean more than that. Now there's different ways you can computing details, but when we say the market is more concentrated, we just mean the big firms are getting a bigger market share. And now the question is that a good sign or a bad sign? So the first thing as an economist to emphasize is, of course, that the market share of the big firm is the result of their behavior, their innovation, that of their competitors, and the market equilibrium. So it does not come from nowhere, right? So you cannot say a priori whether higher concentration is good or bad, because it depends where it's coming from. And now that can be a bit complicated. And so in the book, I try to simplify by just looking at two polar cases. That's why I call them good and bad concentration. As a side note, it turns out it's not a bad description, because in the data, you do see these clusters. Okay. So even though it's a simplification, I think it's a useful one. So good concentration is very easy to imagine. Imagine you have a market where you have the leading firm, say the leading firm has 20% market share. And then that leading firm turns out to be also the better firm at innovating. So it gets even better. When it gets even better, so the market share of that leading firm goes from 20 to 30, I mean, maybe from 30 to 40. Okay, so what you're going to see in the data is that measures of concentration are going to go up. But it's not for any evil plot. It's just because the leading firm happens to be the better one, at innovating. And therefore, this concentration that you measure is just the consequence of something which is pretty fundamentally good, which is innovation. So if it happens that way, then you're gonna see concentration, but it's gonna come together hand in hand with productivity growth, quality improvements, and lower prices. So that's why I think it's fair to call that good concentration. Now you can contrast that with another example where you would have a bunch of leading firms, and one way or another, they manage to put barriers to entry into their industry. So that means that in the past, they were challenged by new firms, and they successfully blocked entry of new firms. And we can talk about how they can do it. And that way, they are protected. So their market shares become very stable, might even grow over time because they don't face any competition. So again, as an economist, you look at the data and you will see rising concentration. But it's fundamentally of a different kind than the first one, because this rising concentration now is not driven by innovation. It's driven by firms protecting their rents, putting barriers to entry. And so the telltale sign is that this second type of concentration, which I call bad concentration, it's going to come together with lower productivity growth and higher prices. Okay, so that's why I think when we look at the data, we should never look at only one indicator. Concentration is a useful indicator, but it's by no means enough to tell you whether what you're seeing, what you're witnessing is good or bad. And so that's why I wanted to clarify that from the get-go. And then, to me at least, the main job of an economist is to look at the data and try to figure out whether we see more of the good type or more of the bad type. And the main argument in the book is that, unfortunately, in the US over the past 20, 30 years, we've seen more of the bad type than the good type.
That's interesting, because you have been at the start of your career working on finance, and you're a professor of finance. And I think your insight of finance was quite interesting in looking at the data. By linking the Tobin Q with the lower of investment to be able to look at what are the firms which are good and bad. So tell us more generally, what is your
that's a very good example. Economist?
Yeah.
That's what a very is your good, experience fact, that's as how it started.
Yeah.
That's how it started. Exactly. So I actually didn't start by looking at prices or measures of concentration, actually, because that's not really my trade. That's not what I do most of the time. I started looking at it completely differently. I looked at investment, so capital expenditure by firms, both tangible and intangible. And the very simple theory we have is that when funding costs are low and cash flows are high, so think of it as there are different ways you can think of it, but the simplest one is the borrowing cost of firms, like something like the BAA measure of credit or something like that, is pretty low. And firms are making lots of money. So corporate cash flows are high. When these two things are true, then you should see high investment. And James Tobin, the Nobel Prize from Yale, formalized that. And he showed that, in fact, under some condition, there is even like a simple statistics that will capture everything you want to know. And he called that Tobin's Q. And it's the market value of the stock market divided by the book value of assets. And intuitively, it makes sense, because if I tell you funding costs are low and cash flows are high, well, that must mean the stock market is high, because the two things that matter for the stock market is how much money you're making and how much you're discounting it. So if I tell you discount rates are low, so that makes value higher, and on top of it, you make lots of money, intuitively, that's going to show up as a stock market value. It turns out that it's deeper than that, because even if it's not the current cost, but the future costs that are low, or even if it's not current cash flow that are low, but firms are optimistic about the future cash flows, these more subtle questions, they all come back to, you can measure all of that correctly if you look at the stock market. So the key insight was, in theory, when the value of the stock market goes up relative to the stock of installed capital, we should see firms increasing the stock of capital. That's the basic theory. And you can add a lot of frictions and details to make it a bit more realistic, but fundamentally that's it. Now, in the data, that was roughly right for most of the post-war period, until somewhere around 2000, where especially in the US, you see a divergence, because market valuation go up, driven both by lower cost, lower interest rates, if you like, but also a lot by just higher profits. So, corporate profits are pretty much after-tax corporate profits in the US are higher than they've ever been in at least since we have data. So extremely high cash flows by firms, very low funding costs, very high stock market valuation, So then you would have expected that you would see a lot of capital expenditure. So the capital stock should be growing fast. But you didn't see that. In fact, you saw the opposite, which is investment was, if anything, pretty bad. And so the capital stock in the US was not growing very fast. It was growing slower than before, even though the stock market was higher. So I was like, okay, there's something wrong in my equation. So then you can go through the list of potential suspects. And they range from, you know, credit constraints, to taxes, stuff like that. But none of them explain anything. So at the end of the day, there were only two explanations that had some potential. One was market power, and the other one was, you know, set up like interesting measurement issues in intangible assets. And I think both are correct in the sense that part of what we see perhaps, and part of what we see for sure, is that some firms are really investing, but their investment is in intangible assets and we don't measure them very well. So it looks like they are not investing a lot, but in fact, they are investing a bit more than we think because some of their investment we don't measure very well. So that I think is part of the story. It turns out quantitatively, it doesn't explain everything. And a big chunk of what's left to explain is market power. And market power fits the bill as an explanation because if what you see in the data is increasing market power, then you would have at the same time monopoly rents. So therefore, you know, lots of stock market values are gonna go high and then cash flows are gonna go high. But it's gonna come with lower investment, not more investment, because a monopoly doesn't like to expand its capacity. And so I was like, okay, so that's not a proof, right? But just saying like, it's a bit like Sherlock Holmes, you know, you have like, this is your case. That's what you want to figure out. You look at 20 different hypotheses. None of them makes any sense. You check them out and then you're left with one or two. And therefore it must be, or at least it's some hint that that must be the explanation. And so that's the starting point for the book. And then it's about digging deeper to try to make sense of that story.
Now, but what I loved in your book is that the use of the finance theory and try to expand it to competition policy and using stopping queue and develop investment to be able to disentangle those questions. I think it was quite impressive, and I loved it personally very much. Let me switch to something which has external event shocks, which are we create a kind of inflection point. You talk about three for those who know France a little bit. Three has been created by a big by a businessman. I will not name it, Paul, just, but you know, it was company. And he was a big disruptor of the market. So in 2011, he was granted a license and he was able to cut prices significantly. And the incumbent will follow a little more and more, as that was at the beginning. Another big event, which shaped a little bit in the other direction, things was 9/11 in the US. And you discuss both events in your book. Do you want to comment it?
Yeah, So I view this lens of, you know, let's try to figure out what's going on. And I think that I provide like a bunch of suggestive evidence that we've seen a rise in market power in the US. So then I like, okay, so what should I do next? Maybe I should look at other places around the world to compare what's going on. And then Europe is natural because they share many, first of all, they trade a lot and then they have relatively similar technologies. So it's easy to compare. You know, like if you think about the banking industry, it's going to be very hard to compare, say Kenya with the US, right? Because Kenya is leapfrogging, you know, forget the bank branches, they do everything online. So how am I going to compare these two industries? Like, I have no idea, the technology is too different. Europe and the US, good thing is for most industries, it's very similar. It's the same technology. So that's an apple to apple comparison. So I go to Europe data, I say, I'm going to find the same thing. And boom, much to my surprise, I find that this kind of trend in market power doesn't happen in Europe. If anything, it looks like it's going the other way. And so then I start to think about what could be explaining this diverging trends. And at that point, you need to be a bit more granular. You need to look industry by industries because the trends, some of the patterns are like broad, but if you look at the reason, what's actually happening in real time, the stories are slightly different. And so the telecom was the starting point because, as you said, actually, like anybody who's had experience living in Asia or Africa, it's the same thing. I mean, it doesn't matter if you come from Singapore, from India, from the Ivory Coast, or from France, like the the change in the relative price of telecoms that used to be cheap in the US, expensive in your country, and now it's the opposite. And like everybody comes to the US like, why are you paying $80 a month for a cell phone bill? Like in any other country in the world, but like, that's insane. It should be 20, you know, 25 maybe. And so I thought that the telecom is a good test case. And the telecom is interesting because it's not just a story of, I think, things getting worse in the US, but also a story of things getting better in other countries. So to me, it's the US started from a baseline of pretty competitive industries, but they rested on their laurels. They let too many mergers happen. And then that advantage eroded over time. So the US got worse. But then other countries, France being a great example, started from a pretty bad position where the markets were very much non-competitive. But then via some series of decisions, some like the one you mentioned in 2011 of granting a license for this new operator free to enter the mobile market, they made the market more competitive. And the good thing there is I could trace, you know, I know when it happened, so I could see the price before and after, and then show that was just a massive effect. You know, we're not talking about 5%, we're talking about the price dropping 50%. So France was 20% more expensive than the US, and now it's 30%. In fact, now it's more like 40% cheaper than the US. So it's just an absolutely massive change in prices. So immediately you can see it in the data, you can see it in consumer pay, just everything. The airlines is also interesting because it's a little bit the same in the sense that, you know, in Europe, we used to have this national, you know, like Air France for France, okay? And then they were all very protected with strong lobbies, making sure that nobody could, you know, compete with them. And that's why airplane travel was way more expensive in Europe than in the US. And then kind of the same thing happened. So in the US, after 9/11, there was a huge shock to the industry. And that probably was a rationale for maybe move. So at that time, just to be clear, the US had 8 major airlines, 8 carriers national. Today it's 4. So post 9/11, big shock, you know, maybe need for restructuring, some saving, some costs. You could make the argument that you should go down from 8 to 7, maybe 7 to 6. But the idea of going to go from 6 to 5 and 5 to 4, that's crazy. And yet they did it. So, and that's how they end up today with a very, very oligopolistic, cartelized and expensive and low quality industry. And in France, in much of Europe, we did the opposite. Not very fast, you know, but like EasyJet, you know, started to build its network, and Ryanair the same thing. And these mavericks are to the airlines what Free was to the telecom. And then we let the maverick enter, and then they start competing and prices start to go down. So that I thought was a pretty striking
event. But what you said was, Thomas, what you said was very interesting in your covers, in the discussion in your book. You talk about institution, all this about a regulator, institution, merger, you trace a little bit what happened in the US with some judge decision in Chicago, mm-hmm. which influenced a lot the way people were looking about concentration. And you talk about Europe and say, you know, because of the features that you have in the European Union, there's a kind of national equilibrium, which make that you don't think that there will be easily a big reversal unless there is something happen with China, for instance. So that's what I understand from your comment.
Exactly right,
You want to say more about this to people who are listening to us?
Yeah, so you know, if you grant me that, you know, we see this diverging trend in market power, if I can trace it back to regulatory actions, sometimes the regulatory actions, like in the case of telecom, it's pure, you know, licenses. So it's very much like a barrier to entry that you remove. And I should mention, these are hard decisions. Like this is, you're not just giving a license. You give a license, you give a right to operate, you force the existing operator to rent some of their network so that to give a leg up to the entrant. So these are like hard cases. It's not like easy to do, but you know, Europe managed to do it and consumers were better off from it. If you grant me that this is happening in several industries, that explain at least part of what we see in the data, then the next question is, how come the US and Europe ended up making relatively different decisions? So now you need to go look at the policymakers, you know, what are they thinking? You could argue that, well, Europe and the US make different decisions because they have different economies, different markets, and stuff like that. And I think that's true sometimes. But remember, like we look at the telecom of the airlines, it's the same planes, the same, everything is the same. So there's no reason why technology would be that different. So I think it's more fruitful as an intellectual exercise to look at decision by regulators or policymakers. And there, I think that I discovered something that I never thought about before, but I believe captures some of what's going on in Europe and some of what's going on in the US. So the tradition of free market and typically comes together with independent regulators. Okay, markets are not free by themselves. They need to be monitored and strong rules must be enforced. And to do that independently from political pressure, you need to have independent regulators. So that's a very Anglo-Saxon tradition. It was strong in the UK for a long time. And of course, by implication, it was strong in the US as well. And that was not the tradition of continental Europe. Continental Europe was much more a tradition of politicians running the show, firms sometimes being just public, owned by the state. And even when they are not owned by the state, politicians would have a very strong, heavy-handed approach to mergers and all of that. So definitely not the tradition of free market with independent regulators. So say that I tell you there's a group of 12, 14, 18 countries who get together. And most of them, I mean, apart from the UK, all of the other ones have a tradition of, having pretty heavy-handed politician involvement in these regulations. And you think, and I ask you, tell me what are they going to agree together for the rules for the union as a whole? Okay. Well, I think a plausible answer would be, well, they're going to do more or less at the union level what they all used to do back at home. Right, that would be like a natural intuition. And that's not at all what they did, actually. That's not what they did for the ECB. And that's not what they did for the DG Comp. They made these institutions much more independent at the EU level than their own antitrust authorities back at home. So you're like, that's weird. So why? It's like, it's a bit like schizophrenia. Like, why would they decide one thing when they're in Paris and something completely different when they're in Brussels? That's kind of weird. But then when you think about it, it is not that weird because the game is different. And the game at the EU level is you want to protect yourself against other countries teaming up against you. And I think it's true for France and Germany, but I think it's even more obvious for relatively smaller countries. If you tell the Netherlands or Belgium, you're going to join the EU. But by the way, anytime there is a hard decision to make, France and Germany are going to agree together and do whatever the heck they want. Maybe you're not going to join. See what I mean? Like that would not be a place. So, and for merger decision that impact your citizens, like clearly these are very important. So these countries would have zero interest in joining a union where the big firm or the big governments could just, decide for everybody else. So these guys insisted on having very independent regulators. In fact, even that was also true to some extent for France and Germany, because you could say, well, if you're a really big country, maybe you don't want the regulator to be independent because, you carry a lot of weight, you could influence the regulator in your favor. Well, that's true, but you're not hegemonic. Even if you're a big country, if all the other ones decide against you, that's not going to work. So you're more worried about other countries influencing the regulator in a way which is to your disadvantage, than you're attracted by your influence on the regulator. And so what happens, the paradox is that all these countries, even though they don't have the historical tradition of independent regulators, they're gonna agree that for them together as a club, that's the best rule. And they're gonna make the regulator very independent. I think that explains the paradox otherwise of why we have a central bank in Europe, which is actually more independent than the Fed is in the US. So then, there are two explanations. One is, the Europeans believe in Milton Friedman more than the Americans. I think that makes no sense. That can't be the explanation. The other explanation is it's a strategic choice that reflects the fact that this is the only agreement that could hold them together. And I think the same exact thing happened for the DG Comp, which is why we ended up producing in Europe an institution that by, all objective measures look very much like something you'd see in the US. So I think that was the key insight. In the US, Again, it's a bit like the same story as before, which is the US started from a place where they had very strong independent regulators, but they weakened over time. The story of how they weakened goes further back in the past. It goes to back 70s. And it's more like maybe in the US, it's like the story of the backlash. Maybe they went a bit too far being proactive. And then there was a backlash saying regulators shouldn't do anything. That backlash was embedded in the Chicago school. But that backlash went too far, which was it went all the way to let's do nothing.
So you said also something which is important that we all face in practice, is that institutions take time to change. Yeah. There is actually you document that in the case of the EU to bring the number of countries with regulation which are less flexible than the one in the US, it took roughly from 95 or 97 to 2010 or 15. That was the majority. Yeah. It's pretty a lot of time. And you are talking also about it in one of your talks that I listened to. You are mentioning that in the US as well, it will require some work at the federal level. I don't want to discuss politics, it's a bit more complicated. But what you said is that maybe at the state level, you are seeing maybe a possibility of evolution, which it would be much faster than at the federal level. Can you comment about the time dimension of institutional adjustment in that process?
Yeah, so, I mean, I guess people like you will not be surprised that, when we look at the data, we find that it takes time to build institutions or make them change. I think that's part of your job to some extent. But I think that the one thing that was striking still is it's relatively slow, but if it's steady, it still works. You just need to set your expectations right. You're not going to have like an overnight shift in everything. That's just not going to happen. But if you're steady and you do industry by industry, after 10 or 20 years, you see a very significant difference. So it can work. But the lesson was it works, but you need to have some kind of constant pressure. And so constant pressure, you see, like it has to be a bit structural. You can do one big decision, put a lot of political capital and then do something, but it's hard to repeat that. And then in topics like antitrust, or there's so much you need to do and you have to build something that works. So it's technically very challenging. So you need to really build for the long run. And the only way that can happen in my mind is you need to have the system, which is organized in such a way that there's a structural pressure. Like it doesn't happen by chance. It's kind of steady and stuff. And in Europe, we kind of did that because we did the DG Comp, which was independent. Then it started doing its job properly. That put pressure on the national regulators, who themselves then became better. And that was a little bit self-enforcing. And the key there was the interaction between the federal level, the EU level, and then the state. And that interaction, sometimes you can think of it as that's like a conflict, like a turf battle. But if you play the game well, you can turn that conflict into a positive force for change in the right direction. Now, in the US, I think it's a little bit the same story. At the federal, trying to do everything at the federal level is very hard. First of all, sometimes it's just not the right tool. And then we see it extremely well today with the broadband issue. Because we talked about cell phones and airlines, but a bigger issue in the US also is broadband access. You have some communities, and that was strikingly shown during COVID, where you had kids who had to go sit at McDonald's to be able to go online for their classes because they couldn't get any internet access at home. So they were on parking lots with their laptop to get on Zoom for their classes. That was like in the US. It was shocking. Well, that's not by chance, because broadband is extremely expensive in many places in the US and extremely badly regulated and extremely monopolized. But that has nothing to do with the federal level. It's almost entirely at the state level. Because of course these are local markets and the regulations are local. And if you want to do something, it has to be at the state level. So that's why I think that you need the state involved for sure. And then like all the big cases in the US that have been successful, they tended to involve the state and the federal working together. And you can have this positive also emulate. Competition is too strong, but you know, it's good for the state to do their things and to put pressure on the federal government to do something as well, and vice versa. So I think that, at least in my mind, making progress in the US requires this. If it's all at the federal level, I'm pretty sure it's going to go nowhere. But if it's plays rightly between the federal and the state level, I think there is a good chance.
Let me shift to something else. All the reviews I've read of your book are just raving. So I say everybody, and I really agree with them. It's a great contribution. I think very well in the French tradition of Tirol and Lafont, and doing a great contribution to the literature on this issue of competition. But there is an interesting review on the German Economic Literature (JEL) of Jan Eekhout, and he discussed two important features. One is the use of the I will not name the index, we call it just SHI. It is an index that you use to measure concentration. Mm-hmm. And he talks about that and say, you know, discuss it. Okay. And I would like to hear your view on it. But also he talked about the role of technological change and that you are also talking about in your book. Do you want to a little bit comment about these comment made by Jan?
Of course. So first of all, Jan has done some great work on these topics as well. Jan with his other Jan Kotter. We said the Jans because that we don't need to butcher their last names when we do that. So it's Eekhout and Delocker and Kotter also as well. So they've done a lot of great work on these same topics, and I think there is much we agree on, and then some where we don't fully agree. So the part where we agree is concentration. But I think that's why I wanted to start the book by good versus bad concentration, so that it's all very clear that concentration itself is not an indicator you can rely on to know whether what you're witnessing is good or bad. You need to think about what's driving it. I think that's, we all agree on that. There is a bunch of other subtle issues with concentration, but on the other hand, I don't think we should push that argument too far, in the sense that if you look at a big market like the US economy, and you see an indicator that's been stable for many years and it starts to go in a different direction, you need to think about what's going on. It doesn't tell you what's going on is bad, but you need to think about what's going on. And I think one issue that I see in the more specialized work of IO, industrial organization, is that because they've shown in many cases in which concentration is just a bad measure of what's going on, but then they went too far. So we don't even want to look at it. I think that's a mistake. If you're Bayesian, you use all signals. You recognize the signals might be biased. You recognize the signals are very noisy, but Bayesian never throw away information. And I think that on that one, that would be my position forever, which is the fact that concentration start changing, it is not telling you that something bad is happening, but you need to monitor it, because that's telling you something is happening and it's useful. And I think that what we've seen in the US is in academia is a little bit of a market failure. And I think I compare it, not in the book, but in some discussions, I compare it a bit with what happened in finance in the 2000s. I think there was a pretty strong market failure in academic research in finance in the 2000s, which is part of the reason that we were not prepared for the financial crisis of 2008. Some people didn't do their job. Some people looked the other way, oftentimes for the wrong reasons. I think a little bit the same happened with antitrust. I think that some people were asleep at the wheel and did not, push for actions against new monopolies when they were being created, which is like 10 or 15 years ago. And that's the job. Just like the finance, like if you're a specialist of banking and financial crisis, and you have nothing to say in 2006 about bank leverage, I think that's a problem. And bank, by the way, it's a good comparison. Bank leverage, completely endogenous. Same thing, tells you nothing about what's going on. But if it's changing, you should pay attention. You could be changing for the right reason or for the wrong reason, just like concentration. And many people in finance were asleep at the wheel and didn't have anything to say useful to policymakers before the big crisis and Lehman Brothers. Of course, after, it's too late. And everybody's going to jump and say, oh, you know, it's bad. Well, no, too late. You should have said that 2 years before. The same happened to some extent in IO, I think. So that's why I believe that we should keep monitoring these indexes, even if we agree they are not perfect. The place where I disagree a bit with the Jans is when they compare them with Europe and the US. And I think, so they view the rise of market power as something which is all over the world. And I think that's mixing up the rise of intangible assets with the rise of market power, which are correlated, but not the same. And I think that some of what they pick up in their work is the fact that many firms everywhere, of course, so that's true in Korea, that's true in Japan, that's true in Africa, that's true in Europe, that's true in the US. All the firms around the world are investing more and more into intangible assets and intangible activities, which means that their cost structure is going to change. It's going to look like maybe they have a higher short-term markup. Okay. So that I think is a global phenomenon, which is definitely happening everywhere, both in the US and in Europe. But I don't think that's what I'm looking at in my data. I think that above and beyond that, there's an issue of market power that's become relatively worse in the US than in Europe. So they push more the technological part, which is common to all countries. And I emphasize that that's part of the story, but I don't think that's what's driving the difference between the US and Europe.
Let me just, before we end the conversation, talk a little bit about developing countries. But let me, as a transition to emerging countries, emerging economies, to talk about trade. When someone, I think, was asking one talk about trade, your answer was a big grain of trade is exchanging information about regulatory practice, regulatory practice. And that is basically when income levels are converging across country. That will be that is what trade is bringing. Hopefully, you will see that exchange information among regulator helps them to learn from situations which are similar. And I will later on maybe ask you a question about India, which is maybe another country which might be entering a little bit closer to the type of countries that you have been looking at being EU and Europe. You want to comment a little bit about all these barriers to the non-tariff barriers that have been raised in trade now, and how it impacts the conversations that we're having today?
Yeah, so trade of course is central to when you think about competition and with policy, but it enters in different ways. So I think it's useful to try to separate them a little bit. So the first thing is, in many countries, so let's make it simple. Suppose you're a small country, and then some industries have relatively high returns to scale. You will not be able by yourself to maintain more than one firm in that industry, or maybe even one is expensive. Okay. Well, so then you could say, well, I'm doomed. I'm going to have a monopoly or nothing. Or you could use trade to bring in foreign competition. Okay, and I think, so that's kind of the classic case where trade can bring in competition to your country in a place, in an industry, which otherwise would be kind of more or less monopolistic naturally. So that's, I think that's good. And we've seen many countries doing that in the telecom, actually. We see that happening in Europe. So Free, for instance, and done in France, but then had positive spillover effect in many of the neighboring countries. So that's kind of the example. Then it also works if you're a relatively larger country because you can always bring in competition from abroad. Now, the main thing is that's where there's a difference between domestic and foreign competition, which is it's much harder to redistribute the gains from trade from global trade than from domestic competition. Domestic competition is kind of win-win because it's one of your firm winning against another. So naturally things are going to balance out. And then it's going to be relatively easy to take care of unemployment, a job transition, and stuff like that, because the winners and losers are in the same country. With foreign trade, You can still get the benefits of competition, so consumers are going to be happy, but it might be hard to redistribute the gains because gains and losses, because they are, some of the gains are going to be abroad and some of the losses are going to be at home, and it's not going to be so easy to redistribute. So I think that's kind of the one key issue with trade, which is why it's more difficult sometimes to do in practice. And what we've seen in recent years is, you know, lobbying by many industries to try to, you know, get back to their monopoly rights by preventing foreign competitors. And of course, we've seen a lot of that in we've seen a fair amount of that in the US, relatively more during the last presidency. And all the data we have, there's lots of nice research papers on that now, show that, yeah, the consumers lost. US consumers lost. Every time there was a barrier to entry erected, the US consumers lost. So I think that's kind of the main effect of trade. And that's why we as economists, you know, tend to be in favor of trade.
Yeah. We at IFC try to do something which is very similar to what you're advising. We are creating a department of disruptive technology, which aims at disrupt markets where we think. And actually, one of the interesting investments that we have was in startup in fintech and transfer. Mm-hmm. As you know, for instance, in Africa, the cost of the fees attached to transaction has been very high, and there were some incumbent, dominant player stories that you know. And we invested in a startup and a couple of startup, which been able to significantly bring the cost down, basically. By 80% the cost and abuse of welfare gains that we have at the consumer level. So something that is part of our strategy. And we're also working on issues of some time, you know, there is a level of concentration which is also needed. So there's one question that I would like to have your opinion on, because we are starting to face it in some countries, which is on the telecom sector and the spectrum distribution. And the traditional approach was to have as many competitors in the market to slide the spectrum, to have a small spectrum, and to be able to bring a cost down, price down. But at the same time, because of technological constraint, some services were not able to be provided appropriately. You know, telemedicine and so forth. And there is now a new trend of investors who are asking to have to balance a little bit that and offer larger spectrum so that they can, and to have an output-based type of regulation where people want to have access to school, access to education, access to name it, and to try to measure that as an outcome to be it's the way they are regulating, instead of just having a profit motive or a maximizing profit motive by the state. What do you think of that conversation, particularly in countries which haven't reached the SDGs and which are for policymakers very much driven by the issue of access and the issue of service provided in remote areas?
Yeah, so I think that's. It's a very important topic, and it's also obviously, as you mentioned, very complicated. The first thing I want to tie up with a question we were asking earlier about what we can learn from each other. And to me, that's one of these examples where, you know, fintech startups, it seems to me that much of the world learned a lot from the UK, because the UK was the first one to kind of formalize the idea that in the fintech world, it's good to have, because finance, of course, is one feature of finance is it's a lot of regulation for good reasons, because, you know, you have the money laundering issue, you have the systemic risk issue. So we have lots of regulation. Well, that makes entry difficult. Okay. So then the UK had this idea that we should have like the sandbox approach where, you know, if you're a little startup and you play in the sandbox, that means you're not very big, then the rules could be lightened up for you. And then when you grow to be larger, then we start imposing all the rules, all the burden. But to get you started, and I think that idea percolated throughout the world. And now crypto countries do it differently. But the basic idea, I think, is something that most regulators around the world recognize as pretty much like a good idea. So that's one example of learning. And then in these access, that like the trade-off between efficiency and distribution, really, you could imagine a world in which the big cities have super fast internet and it's very efficient, doesn't cost much money, but then all the rural areas are left out. And it could be in some measure, could be a relatively efficient way of running things, but it'd be very unequal and we would not want that solution. So the question is, how do you redistribute and how do you force the, how do you make sure that there's some kind of level playing field so everybody can access the, now, I still believe the first tool should be competition in the following sense. Let's go back to free. Well, free is cheap. And it's the fact that it's cheap means that people can afford it. And that's kind of that's really like the first order effect. And if you're in a rural area, it is still cheap. Okay. Now broadband connection. The first pillar should still be competition, which is even in a rural area, you can define the rules.
Let me interrupt you because there is something, the technological issues, which is quite interesting. 5G is in between. 5G has features of broadband and has feature also or a classic and traditional thing. So, and I see that even in the UK, in the new license, the way they try to regulate the new 5G, they are taking a little bit more into account this distributional impact that you are mentioning.
Or even the scale of the required investments.
Yeah.
And so I think that once you put competition as the first pillar to make things work well, then if you recognize that, sometimes the scale of investment or the need for broad access or distribution is very high. And so you can at the margin change a bit your approach. For instance, you can allow some of the, you have four competitors, you keep four competitors, but you allow them maybe by pairs of two to share some of the network development costs. Now that's gonna weaken competition, but you're still gonna keep four competitors. So, it's gonna weaken question a little bit, but it's gonna give you a big boost on the CapEx spending side. And then that's a trade-off you want to make. But I think it should still be like competition first, and then we are just at the margin. Because in the US, you see, they kind of do it the other way, because they sort of gave up on having competitive broadband in many places. So they just say, okay, we're gonna have a monopoly in this region anyway. And then we're gonna just, force the monopolies, gonna tell them, look, if you want to be able to provide access to that city, which is very profitable to you, then we're gonna require you also access the countryside. And but still maintaining monopoly. And that to me is really third best. Like, you should do that in a competitive structure. I think that's kind of, because otherwise I think the political economy is very tricky. And, it should not be the job. Like, you're asking firm, you're saying, I'm going to give you a monopoly rent. And in exchange for that, you're going to do some of the welfare stuff that I should be doing. I think that's third best. And I think that to the extent we can avoid it, we can. And it's not, but the thing is sometimes the politicians do it because it's more comfortable for them. They don't have to pick the political fight. But I don't think that's always a good reason to do it that way.
Yeah, an instrument or objective. So now, thank you so much, Thomas. It's Professor Philippon. It's a pleasure to, I know that you can talk for a long time and I will be, it's really a pleasure to hear the insight you're providing. But let me just say that that conversation, we would like to have it even deeper, because we're talking to Professor Philippon about a conference that we could organize jointly on these issues, where we bring him and other prominent researcher to discuss issues of competition and the impact he has on welfare, on development, on consumer welfare. So, but this is a teaser of that conference, if we manage to have it as we plan. But more importantly, I would like really to thank Professor Philippon for taking the time to comment about his book and tell us the findings that are influencing a lot of people, because I heard a lot of discussion around his book, comments, and everybody universally says that's a great contribution. So, Professor Philippon, thank you very much for taking
Makhtar,
the time.
Thank you so much for talking with me.
It's a pleasure. Thanks so much.